Rosh Hashanah weekend? It is Sunday and Monday. When I say that, because it starts, I believe, Sunday 6 o'clock, and then it goes on to the next day at 6 o'clock. And that is Israel's with the shifting that new year. That's generally, that's a Jewish calendar for the new year. And there's some really good prophetic words about that. One of them is, it is the season of Joseph, which is the camels are coming in, which means that there is going to be prosperous. Very, like camels, they are loaded, you know, when they're coming. The camels also go through the desert. I'm not going to prophesy that for you. But there's some good things coming. But there's also the whole 80. Like right now we are 5783, I think. I think that's how it goes. I'm not sure. But the last one is 83. But the whole 80s is speaking about warfare. We are going to be continually in warfare. One of the things that we have to be very keen on and aware of is that there are going to be people that are going to be rubbing you the wrong way, have rubbed you the wrong way, and that this is going to be this 80 season that we are in. We have to learn how to handle those offenses. Because when we're going into warfare, there's going to be more of that coming. Pandemic was like it drew the worst out in people. It doesn't matter what area you want to fight in. If there's a fight in you, it'll come up. If there's something in you that God needs to deal, it comes up. So this next season that we're moving in, warriors are needed. Warriors are needed strongly. A word across Canada, they did a 40-day fast, just finished it. And what he got was boots on the ground. Boots on the ground. And it's time for a war season. And the other one is, and I'm sure maybe some of you have heard it on the firewall or maybe on different, oh, it's good to see you again, and Monica. And you've heard about it that, I lost my train of thought. Bring it back, God. Yeah, I know. Warfare, boots on the ground. You know what, I think they mentioned it. I don't know if this is it, but this is one thing I wanted to tell you, that this is also the season and the year of the women to coming forward. The women apostolically coming forward. It's time for the women to rise up as warriors and roarers. Right now, roar. Roar. Roar over your family. Roar over your situation. Rise up, O woman of God. Roar. Roar, be that apostolic where you hear God and you declare it in there. I'm already starting preaching, but it's not what I'm talking about. Well, it is sort of. Daniel, you just flag me when you are ready. Okay, we're all good. So worship team, why don't you come up? We'll do some of this other stuff, prophetic and anything else. We have, for those that are leaving tonight, just, I don't have to tell you, you guys are women. You will leave your rooms spotless, like an extra blessing. So thank you for that. Tomorrow, checkout is at 9 o'clock. So there will be coffee tonight after. Probably some leftovers. Oh, that reminds me. So good. Who agreed? Oh, and they said, I want the recipe. And you know what that is? Taste and see. Lord is good. And that's what happens when you experience the Lord. When you are in His presence, when He speaks to you, you want, I want that recipe. I want more. How did you do that? All of you can talk. All of us can hear God. And we can all hear. So, with that, blessings to you, Sherry. I will not forget you this time. bring us into the presence of the Lord.
I just want to add a little thing, if it's okay, Shirley, to what you were just saying, that we can all prophesy. So I've been a Christian for a very long time, at least 50 years. And my husband, I always felt like he was like the prophetic one, and I would be in all these sort of prophetic things I thought was amazing, but I didn't feel like I heard anything, didn't feel like I saw anything. But about 15-ish years ago, landed up being in this house of prayer where we would practice the prophetic every week. And so I just thought, well, any thought that comes to my mind, I'm just gonna say it. I'm not a risky person. Even to say the word risk, that kind of lands up putting up a wall for me. But I thought, I'll just say it. Well, you know what I found out? I found out that I hear God a lot. And I had been hearing God a lot. But I had thought it was my own thoughts. But it really was God. I guess, in a sense, I thought that I had such great thoughts. But the truth was, I have a God. I have a God who has great thoughts, and he was sharing them with me. And so I would not even necessarily classify myself as being like the prophetic person, but I do hear God. And so I don't even care whether someone thinks I'm prophetic or not, but I get to hear God because he's my Father, and he wants me to know him, and Jesus calls me his friend. He says, I tell my secrets to my friends. So I don't know if that encourages you, but, you know, I was in my 40s before I thought I could really, really hear God, and now I hear him all the time because I'm listening differently. Anyways, let's stand. I just want to say, you all can hear. The Lord's given you ears to hear, and ask him, and he's going to show you. So here we go. I'm going to do a song you know. Found yet. Oh, it's good. That the Lord is putting on my heart those who are searching for answers. So let's just lift up the names of those that we love, the ones that the Lord is highlighting to us, who are searching for answers. Thank you. Thank you, Father. You are a good You're the beautiful one. We love your name. How we love your name, Jesus. You're the beautiful one. We love your name. Let's try that again. And how we love your name, Jesus. You're the beautiful one. You're the beautiful. holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. And doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. And I'll never be more loved than I am right now. I'm going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice singing in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. And you would cross an ocean so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now. And Jireh, you are enough. And Jireh, you are enough. And I will be content in every circumstance. And Jireh, you are enough. And don't want to forget how I feel right now. On the mountaintop, I can see so clear what it's all about. Stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't want to forget how I feel right now. 'Cause Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough. And I will be content in every circumstance. Jireh, you are enough. I'm already loved, I'm already chosen. I know who I am, I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I can imagine, and that is enough. That is enough, because I'm already loved, already chosen. I know who I am, I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I could imagine, and that is enough. Yes, that is enough. Oh, that is enough. like to just pray a prayer thanking the Father. And then we're going to do the same with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. But does someone want to just speak out a prayer praising the Father? Anyone?
Father, we declare that you are good all the time. God, in every season, you are good. You are faithful. We love you, God. We love you, Father, our Abba in heaven. God, we thank you that when we ask you for a fish, you don't give us a snake. If we ask you for an egg, you don't give us a rock. If our earthly parents so care for us, how much better are you than any parent? God, we honor you as our Father. We give you full authority to parent us, to father us, to be gentle and tender and to lead us and to guide us and to grow us up into the wisdom of God. Come, Father, come and be amongst us. We love you, we honor you, we bless you, Father.
Prayer to the beautiful Son, Jesus. Jesus became man. We can relate to you. You walked among us. You call us friends. We love you, Jesus. We love your love for the Father. We love how you listened to your Father and you said, I don't do anything of my own accord, but I only do what I see my Father doing. You've shown us what the Father's like. You said that when you look at me, you see the Father. And we wouldn't know the Father apart from you. So we say, thank you, Jesus. We thank you that you are risen and you are victorious. You conquered death, you conquered sin, and you have purchased our righteousness, and that you pursue us as the bridegroom. And you are looking forward to the day when we will be reunited with you as your bride. You're radiant, you're sparkling, you're pure bride. And Jesus, we love you and we say, worthy is the Lamb.
Yes.
Worthy is the Lamb that was slain from before the foundations of the earth.
Yes.
Worthy is the Lamb to receive all the glory, all the honor, all the dominion, and all the power.
Yes.
From now and forever. And we thank you, Lord, you will have your inheritance among the nations. The Father has promised to give you the nations as your inheritance. And we declare that you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Lord of the earth. You alone are the Lord of our lives. And we gladly surrender ourselves to you, Lord Jesus. There is no one like you. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. The mystery. Love that you are mysterious, God. Yes. Yes, we do. your presence. Increase your presence. Fall afresh. Fall afresh. Say, come on in, come on in. We open the door, we open the door, we open the door. We say, come on in, come on in. We open the door, we fling wide the door.
Take this time, the staff, like the women's staff, if you could stand up, please. We want to say thank you to you. It's Tess, and Lindsay, and Sandy, and Val. There should be some more, right? Who's missing here? Ruth? Yeah, there's Ruth. Yeah, there she is. And then there's another gal. Well, there's Tanya out there, right. Okay, you got everybody? Okay, so they're going to be giving you just a tiny gift. And it's a gift that Monica Penner made, or she created it, she wrote it. And I bought enough off of her. She was supposed to come this weekend, but her dad had died at the funerals actually today. But she says part of her could actually be here. So it's a gift that she created. And then the paper there, it's actually the accumulation of all the prophetic words we've given to the women over the years. It's like, I won't say all, because not all of them I had on my computer. So, but it's a lot. So you can go through a whole month, one a day, or you can You can just do it all in one day. You can also use it to give it to other people. If there's words in there that you, this will fit so-and-so, I would actually encourage you to give it to other people. And if it's a guy, you can change it from daughter to son, if it fits. So would our team go to these people, and while Sherry is still worshiping here, would you pray for the staff here at Rockwell? Do open that door, Lord. Father, first of all, you say, behold, I stand and I knock. And that knocking, Lord, isn't just for salvation. It's for relationship. So, Father, we open the door. We open the door. We open the door. We open the door to you, to fellowship, to have intimacy in Jesus' name. We open the door. We open the door.
Open the door.
We open the door. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, I love that scripture that you quoted there, Rebecca, that if you ask for Holy Spirit, the Father will not give you a stone. You know, there used to be such a fear that if you would ask for Holy Spirit and be baptized with the Holy Spirit and ask for tongues, you get a demon. Holy Spirit, you will not get a stone. You will not get something that you don't want. You can trust your Father. You can trust your Father. Thank you, Sherry. Thank you, worship team. Thank you very, very much. All right. So we like to have a few prophetic words, and I think our team might be up for that. There's a few. I cannot remember, you're going to help me, the scripture that has to do with salt, and that, not the salt of the earth, we are the salt of the earth, the one that is thrown into water and the water was filled. Can anybody help me? Does anybody remember the story? Pardon? Oh, Good. While she's checking it up, this is what I saw for you, Ingen. I saw the Lord taking salt and actually putting it around you and in your field and in the water around you. I saw him salting the earth around you. And I know from that scripture that salt is going to bring healing. So, Father, I want to, is that okay? She's going to get the reference for it, and then we can go. Father, I want to pray for Ingen. I pray, Lord God, there is healing needed. There is something that it needs to be healed, and you are seeing it, and you are bringing your salt, and salt is going to just shift it. It's going to be a miracle. It's going to be a miracle. So, Father, I pray joy. I pray hope and confidence. Father, whatever the situation is, Lord, and many, maybe, possibly, Father, let it be healing for the body. Let it be healing for the family. Let it be, Lord God, healing for finances or whatever is needed. Let it be in Jesus' name. All right. Anybody else? We were talking about quirks. One of mine. People's quirks, but this is one of mine. Okay. Who would like to? You want to? When you do speak right into the mic. That's okay. Tracy? Anybody else?
I just want to say, Lord, I just thank you. Thank you, Lord. Okay. Lord, I just thank you for that. Will you just move on behalf of whatever is going on in her relationship, and reconciliation, God, keep alignment over her. And God, I thank you for her hungry heart to seek you out on this stuff. That you would just meet her where she's at. Give her the answers. Give her the strategies and solutions. And God, that you would just show her and lead her. And just bless her. Thank you for healing for her, God. That she would know that she is so loved and that you see her in Jesus' name.
So good to see you. New Jersey, right? Awesome. Okay. Monica, you carry a beautiful of God over Zoom. And your prayers, they pack a punch. There is your faith really makes a mark in the spirit realm, and they carry authority. And so I just want to say to you, I feel like don't give up, don't give in. You've got the devil on the run. So no matter what it looks like, it's making a big difference. break through anointing right now on her and in the situations that she's in. Here, there we go. Okay. Here, you have the most beautiful eyes. It was one of the first things that I noticed about you. And they're not only beautiful in the spirit, in how you see the spirit, and you see and heart of matter. And so go with that. Go in confidence. And so feel free to really walk. Knowing that you see well, sometimes we're hesitant, sometimes we pull back because we're not really. But no, Father, I just pray that you would continue to bless and increase spiritual sight and insight on Shirley. And Lord, I pray it would spill over to her ears, to her heart, to her smell, to her taste, to her touch, that her spiritual senses, all of them, would just come alive. In Jesus' name, for your glory and honor.
Barb, I have one of these chocolate things that says merci, thank you. I feel like the Lord is saying thank you to you. And I see you rowing. I see you rowing in a boat, and it's against stream, and your oars are going, and you're going, and you're getting tired, and pulling a bit to rest, but you don't rest very long. There's something on the inside of you, Barb, that is always, always hungry for God. You're always craving. You're always, and it doesn't matter if you feel like you're standing still or what. And Rose says, thank you. Thank you. So keep on keeping on when it's been really, really hard. So I pray for you, Barb. We pray for you. Father, we pray for the grace, the mercy, the strength, God. Father, I pray angels come on her oars, that, Father, she can go down that river that's so tough right now. God, it's going against stream. And, Father, she's tired. She's weary, Father, but you have been so pleased with her. So impart to her strength in Jesus' name. I have a word. I hope it's right. And I don't know for who it is, but it's calling you out the destiny that God has for you, but it's also, there's a warning to it. And I'm glad I don't know. So it'd be good for my part. God has called, I mean, you're all warriors, but there's a specific someone here that has a gifting in the area of discernment and warring and even in the area of helping other people with demonic. But there has been a dabbling in some areas of whether it be videos or games or something that you may not know that is been giving you trouble in the demonic, but it's weakening your position of the destiny that God has called you. In fact, it has been a tool of the enemy, a weapon of the enemy to try to weaken you and wear you down and so that you do not rise in the actual authority that you have. So what you do, if you feel that you could feel that on the inside of you, that's me, then what you do is you just go to the Lord, you ask God for repentance, and you maybe you even need to be accountable to somebody, but you need to get back out of that into, because you don't want to taint the gifting that God has for you. So I have no clue, and I don't even know if it is anybody here, but that is something that I wouldn't want to leave and let drop here. Anyway, so for today, we are going to, could I get a couple ladies and just move that whiteboard closer here? Because I'm going to be teacher today. what we're going to do at the end is we're going to have a fire tunnel. And the reason is because this whole weekend is about crave. It is about craving Holy Spirit, craving just like that chocolate, you had got a taste of it, now you want more. And going through a fire tunnel, you will get an impartation of Holy Spirit. You will get fire. You will get that boost of fanning to flame in the inside of you. By faith, you will. What happens tomorrow? What happens the next day and the next day? So my message today is going to be more, this evening is going to be more about after you have the fire tunnel. Something to take home with and say, this is what I need to do. It's probably not something new, but maybe the way it's said, maybe different ways that I'm going to bring it about, it may help. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to the story of Mary and Martha. Luke 10, and then this is also the Amplified Version. And we're going to start with verses 38. Before I start, just to clear, you all know the story of Mary and Martha. Martha is not a bad girl. Martha's serving is not wrong. In fact, if you will look up some of the requirements that they have for elders, it talks about hospitality, which means making food. It means it's serving. It's serving. So it is not wrong. And in John, I want to prelude all of what we're talking about tonight with all of this. Martha serving, what she has done is not wrong. And later on, after Lazarus been raised from the dead, it said that Jesus loved Mary and Martha and Lazarus. It's not that he was picking on her. And it says that he came to their home and they served him. And then Mary came and she broke perfume all over his feet. There Martha was serving alone. But this time, Martha didn't have such an issue about it. Whatever it is that we were dealing with tonight about this story, she caught it. So that's what we want to do. So I'm going to read the story with starting with verse 238. And again, it's amplified. Sorry. Sorry that you can't follow along word for word with me. Now, while they were on their way, Jesus and disciples, it occurred that Jesus entered a certain village, and a woman named Martha, by the way, Martha means mistress. It means that she's mistress of her home, okay? And Martha, mistress of her home, received and welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister named Mary who seated herself at the Lord's feet and was listening to his teaching. But Martha, overly occupied and too busy, was distracted with much serving. And she came up to him, to Jesus, and said, "Lord, is it nothing to you that my sister Mary has left me to do all the work alone? Tell her then to help me, to lend a hand, and to do her part along with me." But the Lord replied to her by saying, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, and there is need of only one." Or, "Mary has chosen the good portion, that which is to her advantage, which shall not be taken away from her." But before we talk about Martha, I want to talk about Mary. Mary, it took a lot of courage for her to do what she did. I think you understand that was not the culture at that time for women to go be sitting with the men, and especially at his feet. It was the culture at that time for the women to be on the other side, even if they were listening. They were to be on the other side. And especially in this case, it was Mary and Martha would have been in the kitchen getting things ready. So it took a lot. It took a desperation on Mary's part. Now Mary, the word Mary means bitter. It took a desperation. It took a longing. It took a craving, a hunger. She had to be with Jesus. And where did she get that? First of all, she'd been listening to Jesus' teaching. So do you remember on the road of Emmaus? Is that how you go? And the two disciples were walking along, and Jesus came along with them. And Jesus was explaining the scriptures to them, and they didn't recognize it was Jesus, and later on when Jesus disappeared, what did they say? Did not our hearts burn? You want a burning heart? Then allow Jesus to explain, to teach you. You have to spend some time with him. And so Jesus had heard Jesus, Mary had heard Jesus say to about you know, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. He heard that this is when you pray, go into the secret place, and when God sees you in secret, then he's going to reward you. He heard all the parables of prayer, perseverance, and I know that she didn't hear this yet, but I'll throw it in there anyway, because it was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and Jesus hadn't been there yet. But Jesus said there to him, watch and pray that you do not fall into temptation, for your spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And it says that word temptation, what it actually means in the Greek, it means that you are going to be put under test so that you can have a promotion. The devil tempts you to make you fall. God will never give you a temptation that is sin. That's not his character. But he will test. And the testing time is there to like the disciples there. Are they going to give up their sleep? Are they going to give up their comfort to spend 1 hour in prayer with Jesus? They were under a test, and God wanted to promote them. So Mary understood that there is something very beneficial about being in the presence of Jesus. She knew it here, and she had also knew it in hearing. And now Martha comes along, and you know, just kind of humorous that Martha's trying to tell Jesus. We'll get back to that. But in Mary's case, I want to bring this part out first. Important. Get into the presence of God. When Jesus said, there is one thing that is needful, the word one means absolutely the top, priority, number one. There is no number two. There's one thing, and then it says needful, and that word needful means desperate, necessity of life. One thing is so incredibly important. One thing to the top, to the first thing that you do, the most, you can't even get a word higher. It's a one thing. It's the top. A needful, necessity, desperate, demanding. Like your person who needs insulin. It demands it. It has to have it or it will die. It's demanding. Without. It is my, this, I don't like this term, but it was part of the Greek meaning, duty. It has to be. It has to be. There's one thing that is needful, and Mary has chosen the good. This is the part that has wrecked me. I have so wept before the Lord to apologize, because we all have this life, and we have the enemy and our flesh that pulls us away from that one thing. Isn't that true? All of us, me, you, we have that battle. And when Jesus was justifying Mary, he said, she has chosen the good part. And I'm going to tell you what that good part is. It's a gift above any gift that you could ever have. She's sitting at Jesus' feet, where that looks, where he is teaching you. You are spending time with him. It is a gift above gifts. It's useful. It's advantage. It's admirable. It's excelling in every respect. It's distinguishing you. It's causing you to look. It's causing you to be good ground, fruitful trees, ready to bear fruit in your Christian life. It's causing you to learn of your saving truth, of the saving work of Christ, and you become suited for something, prepared for something good. For upright, honorable, beneficial, kind, generous, riches, benefits of the kingdom of God, righteousness, goodness, and it awakes something in the inside of you. It causes you to become agreeable, joyful, and happy. When we spend time with Jesus, it's not only needful, it's not only desperate, it's desperately needful. When you spend, you get yourself filled up. You get yourself healed. And Mary being bitter, no, I'm not saying she is bitter, but I am going to start using her name. You know, for us, maybe we have some areas of bitterness, or had. I mean, after this weekend, you don't anymore. Maybe you have some offenses. Maybe you have some people in your life. Maybe you have some situations in your life that you don't know how to get healed. Spending time with Jesus, where your heart is burning. The word that you are reading, coming alive on the inside of you. And when you taste that, you want more. Like when I look at the Bible, I go, I want to eat it. It has saved my life. I wish I could tell you story after story of experiences where that word has come and he has saved me from situations and has got me out of the pit and got me that word, the living word, the one that burns in your heart. And how that same word that burns has helped other people. You can't help others. It's very much like when you go on the airplane and it says, first put your mask on, then help others. This is that. You've got it backwards when you want to go serve and help others. When you do not have that filling up on the inside. So, Jesus said one thing is needful. It's absolutely exclusive of anything else. It is demanded. It's desperate. It is most important. And the good part. And you get the anointing on the inside of you. So, what's so big about the anointing? Help me. What's so big about the anointing? It's the anointing that destroys the yoke. So now you kind of have an idea of why the enemy would want to try to get you away from that. The more time that you spend there, the more you're going to put wood on the fire. The more, if you're reading your Bible and you're not getting anything out of it, you cry out to God. And maybe you even need to do some fasting. Because if it's not burning, you are not burning. If God is not speaking to you, you have stepped in. Possibly duty. Possibly it's just, I gotta read my one chapter. We're talking about craving. We're talking about the fire. We're talking about getting our lives so on fire with God that, and continuously. I don't want to burn out. I want my fire to burn. I want to pass it on to my grandkids and maybe even my great-grandkids. But I have to spend that time. I have to make it priority. I know some of you, maybe you're working, you have children. And I really appreciate, Tracy, what you shared, that when you had the children at home, and you said you had worship music. But I want to appeal to you, and I want to make it so that what I'm sharing today, you can see that it is so incredibly important that
that even if you are the busiest woman in all the world, that somehow you cry out and say, God, show me where, show me how, show me where, show me how. Where can I do it? How can I do it? He will reward you. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He is a rewarder if you go secretly into his into the closet and he sees in secret. And he will reward you if you are like Susan Wesley. Apron goes over your head. You have to, I have to find the time, because we have our kids that are going down the drug world, our grandchildren, down into pornography and into everything else that is perverted in our school. Sorry if I'm getting loud. We have to have that burning fire in us so that we can speak to the mountains in our family. I can't do it without the fire, without the anointing. And I'm crying out. God, I'm crying out because my prayers and my secret place have to hit the mark, God, because my granddaughter is going down that road. And we've had some pretty huge warfare in our home. You can't back down, oh lioness. You take charge. And the only way you're going to do it, you can't do it by fighting out there with picket signs. If God tells you to do it, do it. I'm not opposing that, but get that fire burning inside of you first. There is war. My words right now are going to create war against you, because the enemy knows that when you go into that place, that's where you're going to get that anointing. That's where you're going to get the fire. And that's where you're going to get the help. And that's where you're going to learn. And you're going to get others. And not opposing that you can get together with others to pray, for sure. Because wherever there's two or three gathered, one can chase 1,000, two can chase 10,000. Get together with others. But get those fires burning first. So what Martha went through is what we go through. And it's very much along the same line as the second soil of the sower of the seed, where the seed was sown in thorny ground, and the pleasures and the cares and the worries of this world choked out fire. But he will not snuff out. We can still fan that to flame. Okay. So what I want you to do, again, Martha was not wrong in serving. Okay. The King James Version said, Jesus said, you are cumbered. Now the word cumbered in for the Martha means to draw around, going around in circles. Draw away, driven about mentally, over-occupied, too busy, distracted, anxious, annoyed in spirit, troubled, disquieted, caring, like it says careful. So they're caring in a wrong way. They put the care upon themselves. They've got burdened, troubled. So I want to venture to say that Jesus was saying to Martha that her attitude is what's getting her into trouble. And he didn't say it, but he said, Mary has chosen the better. And I almost forgot to tell you that. All that good stuff that you're getting deposited will not be taken away from you. It shall. Nobody can take away that fire. Nobody can take away that word. When God gives you and you know it's him, oh, you can stand your ground. Nobody. Nobody's going to be able to. So, I want you to
some things, and this is going to be a Martha. Martha here. I'm going to say the Martha spirit. Martha was a good girl. Martha spirit. Okay. And it may not only be reflecting what you read there. What are some of the things that are going to distract you from spending quality time with Jesus? Kids, which makes you busy? Okay, kids, anybody else?